Moving to our next part, we can see how to quantify the absorption of light. So now there is one term called as extinction coefficient, and there are many things through which we can define this. But mainly, it actually depends on the wavelength. And suppose there is a light which is inclining, and it is called as I0, and which is having a path length or thickness d, which is being covered, and there has been an extinction coefficient of alpha. So we can simply consider that I is equal to I0 into e power minus alpha d. We need not to go in that detail that we have to use some sort of this equation. We can simply transform this. We can simply calculate by simple I upon I naught ratio. Now, for example, let's discuss this thing. If I is equal to I0, what does it mean? I upon I0 ratio will be 1. This ratio cannot go more than 1. What does it mean? How much light is inclining? The same light which is coming out, and the system on which we are inclining the light is not absorbing anything. Now, suppose if we consider I0 is 10 times more than I, or I is 10 times less than I. In that case, I upon I0 ratio will be 1 by 10 or 0.1. In that case, we can say if we are considering the decimal fraction, the 0.1% is transmitted and remaining 90% is absorbed, or we can say 0.1 decimal value is absorbed, is transmitted, 0.9 is absorbed, or 10% is transmitted and 90% is absorbed. So now we will see a decrease in the transmittance. So how we are exactly trying to count that if we are talking about this log I naught upon I. Suppose in first case it was log I upon I naught or I naught upon I, it is same as 1. So it will be log 1, that is 0. What does it mean? There is no absorbance. Now if you are considering the second situation where there was 90% of the light was absorbed, only 10% was transmitted. So log 1 upon t, or what you can say, 1 upon 0.1. So now 1 upon 0.1 will be 10. Log 10 is equal to 1. In that case, we can say the absorbance is 1. Now we can simply convert this equation as equal to epsilon into c into t. Now here, when we are talking about the epsilon, it is called as molar extinction coefficient. So in that case, the value of what you can say epsilon will be considered according to the molar. Now we can simply convert. If suppose path length, which is d, is 1 unit, and if concentration is also 1 unit, in that case absorbance will be equal to epsilon. What does it mean? If C is 1 molar or 1 mole per liter and D is 1 centimeter, absorbance is epsilon. Now this value is comparatively very high, and we don't calculate it directly through 1 molar concentration. So we take a very lower concentration. We can take 1 micromolar or 1 millimolar, depending on how the absorbance is being produced. And through this, we can calculate the molar extinction coefficient. The overall value is per molar per centimeter, because we take it inverse. So in we can take it mole per centimeter, but it is overall per molar per centimeter. Now here the epsilon, which is actually molar extinction coefficient, molar absorptivity, molar absorption coefficient, it is actually the constant in standard under standard condition, and A is actually the absorbance of the sample, which you actually see in the spectrophotometer. Now again, I have told you because there is less chance of taking higher concentration, absorbance of higher concentration, So what we do, we take only lower concentration, and this law, which is called as Beer-Lambert's law, it is only applicable to the lower concentration. There are two chances. There may be some association of molecule at higher concentration, means two molecules, especially in the case of protein, when you are putting them under higher concentration, they are forming a third level of molecule, okay, third type of molecule. Or there may be some shadowing, means one molecule is actually shadowing the effect of other molecule, and overall this may cause the deviation from ideal behavior. So the molecule should be separate enough to take the proper absorbance. Now there is one more thing. If suppose the solution is containing more than one species, obviously because of this lambda max concept which we have discussed, there is only possibility of taking one absorbance. And what may be happening during that time, although that another molecule is not actually being taken absorbance at its lambda max, means suppose there are two molecules, one is having absorbance as 520 nm, another is having at 540 nm. We are putting 540 nm, and now it is some part of 520 nm species will also be counted. So it means there is some increase in the absorbance by default if there is any type of secondary species is present, although if it may not be sharing the same lambda max. So overall there is an overestimation. And if you are taking higher absorbance, it may go something like non-linear behavior, which is not exactly acceptable. The absorbance should be also always in accordance with the concentration. The main by default is absorbance is proportional to the concentration, and it should be valid all for all the concentrations. But theoretically it is possible, practically it is not possible. There is difference in the linear ratio. Now the next problem is some sort of a strelite. Any instrument is having some sort of extra light, or what you can say stray light. So obviously that stray light may be reaching to the detector, and they will affecting the actual reading. So what we do, we can only concentrate on the light which is coming from the source. So we increase the intensity of the source light so that the effect of stray light should be minimized. Now, if you talk about the derivation, there may be some dimerization of chromophores at higher concentration. Overall, it will be forming what you can say a third type of species. Now, suppose A is our compound. Now, it is forming A2. Obviously, right now, when A is converted to A2, there is another type of species which we are observing. Second thing, for general use, there may be one thing which is called as turbidity. For very common example, we can talk about the bacterial culture. Bacterial cells or bacteria molecule individually cannot absorb any light. But what happens, it can actually scatter. So here is the term which we need to be very particular about: optical density. Because it is not exactly talking about absorbance or absorption of light, but anyhow, because it is deviating the light, so in that case we can say there is scattering. So we are actually measuring only the unscattered light. Now this scattering is also depending on number of particles present. So anyhow, if the concentration or the number of particles become high, number of scattering particles which become high, overall there will be more absorbance, or we can say less transmittance. So we actually take the term optical density. And even if we are doing the same thing on the device like a spectrophotometer, we right now call this as optical density. Although there are separate apparatus, there are nephelometers or cladmeters, they can be taken, but usually the normal spectrophotometer can also be used. Now, why we are using water, this may be another discussion. So there is something like what you can say, a native state is absorbed when you are using buffer or water, and there is no absorption of light when you're talking about the range of 700 to 200 nm. Starting from 200 up to 700 nm, the water is not showing any type of absorption properties. So it is the best because it is providing the native state and it is showing no absorption. Now, in the last part of this lecture, we can talk about the changes happening during the reading of any reaction. Suppose we have set a criteria, but during there is something like change in pH, change in oxidation strength, there is some change in the polarity, obviously this will change the dielectric constant, and there some may be the orientation of the molecule. Overall, these three phenomena will actually change the property of absorbance during the experiment. So, what are the actually effects which we can observe? There are four effects: bathochromic effect, hypsochromic effect, hyperchromic effect, hyperchromicity, and hypochromicity. One by one, we can see this thing. If the wavelength is shifted towards the higher values, because we know something like towards the higher value in the visibility range, there is red color. So, this is called as red shift. Now, we can understand this thing. We can see that this peak is moving towards the higher wavelength. Means right now, we will not be observing this peak here, it may be something here. Second part, we can say hypsochromic shift, or what you can say blue shift. It is called as shifting towards the lesser wavelength. Now, it is something we can say it is shifted towards the lesser wavelength. Means right now peak will be observed something like this. In during these two things, there is not a particular change in the intensity or the value of what you can say absorbance, because it is putting it at the same peak. But now, if you are talking about the hyperchromicity, means there is detection of more color during the what you can say detection during the conduction, and it means now you can see the peak is rising at the same time. Means initially it was giving this, now because of any reason, because of any factors we have talked about, there is higher absorbance, and now there may be something called hypochromicity, where the decrease in the absorbance, and because of any change there is decrease in the color, and we can see the peak will right now be coming like this. So, these are the four effects which we can observe.